This episode was suggested by a listener, Penny R., on Facebook. If you'd like to make a suggestion, you can do so on Facebook and Instagram at Morbid Curiosity Podcast, on Twitter at Morbid Podcast, and on our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com. Also, a huge thank you to Rabbi Chaikin and Rabbi Gutnick of Melbourne for your help and advice on this episode. I really appreciate it. Humans are fascinated by gore and violence, but even more so, the mysterious and unsolved. Interest in these disturbing and unpleasant subjects is called morbid curiosity, and it has gripped hundreds of people throughout the ages. I am one of those people. My name is Hallie, and this is the Morbid Curiosity Podcast. A legendary creature called the Golem has been woven through our modern culture more than we realize. They appear in television shows like The X-Files, Supernatural, and Grimm, in video games like Final Fantasy, Assassin's Creed, and Minecraft, in both Marvel and DC comic book universes, in several major fantasy book series such as The Discworld and Wheel of Time, and in many tabletop games like Dungeons & Dragons and Magic the Gathering. The Golem legend has inspired many classic story tropes in the modern age, and has done so since the stories first arose in early Jewish texts. Before I get into the details of the legend of the Golem, I want to preface that these legends originate in Jewish mythology. I'm not Jewish, and don't proclaim to be an expert in Judaism or its history. I have used scholarly and well-researched sources, as I always do, but as I'm not Jewish, I can't eliminate cultural bias completely, despite my best efforts. I loved reading about this topic, because I have zero previous knowledge, and learning something completely new is one of my favorite things to do. However, due to this lack of previous knowledge, I also felt a little out of my depth when constructing this episode. I want to get this right, so if you have any issues or want to add anything, please let me know, either by email on the MCP website or via direct message on social media. Also, there's a lot of in-depth scholarly work on golems, and some heated debate on certain aspects of the legend and its origins. I've done my best to represent what I read. Again, please let me know if you have any issues. Without further ado, let's talk about golems. There are many versions of the Golem, even in the earliest tales about them. They are seen as a connection between humans and the divine, a servant, a savior, a monster, and sometimes all of these at once. Before we get into why there are so many versions, let's talk about what a Golem is. A Golem is usually a humanoid creature that has been made from a natural substance like clay, dirt, stone, or wood. It's usually magically animated, traditionally by a rabbi of the Jewish faith, or someone who has trained in the secrets of Jewish mysticism. The golem typically must follow the commands of the person who made it, but the commands must be carefully given, as the golem often carries out these commands to the letter, and will not stop carrying them out until told to do so. In most cases, the golem has superhuman strength and invulnerability, but they cannot speak, and can easily be deactivated by the person who created them. This is the most basic and consistent version of what a golem is. The first mention of the word golem comes from the Hebrew Bible in Psalm 139, verse 15 through 16, which speaks of the creation of the first human, Adam. In this context, the word golem means undeveloped substance and implies the figure of man is unfinished before he acquires a soul. The next appearance of the golem is in the Talmud, the collection of ancient rabbinic writings that interpret the Torah, or the first five books of the Bible. Tractate Sanhedrin 65b of the Talmud speaks of a famous rabbi, Rava, who created a man and sent him to another rabbi, Zerah. When Rabbi Zerah spoke to the man could not respond. And because of this, Rabbi Zerah knew that the man had been created by man, not God, and returned him to dust. In the same part of the Talmud, one phrase is interpreted to mean that several famous rabbis used the Sefer Yetzirah, or the Book of Formation or Creation, to create a calf and then ate it. The word golem, however, is not used in the Talmud, but these two examples fit the process of golem creation. Both these stories show that humans do have the power to create life with the assistance of the divine, and as rabbis are the only ones who seem to be able to do it, a person must be very pure in order to create life this way. The lack of speech is a trait that stuck with the golem legend until the late 20th century. According to Gershom Scholem, a Jewish historian and philosopher, there are several historical documents that give instruction in golem making. Two of these are commentaries on the Book of Creation, which according to Jewish scholars was written around 2000 BCE. Another Book of Creation, which was written between the 3rd and 6th century, is the earliest extant book on Jewish esotericism. The contents of the book are not easy to comprehend, therefore the commentaries are used as an interpretation of the book. One of the commentaries on the Book of Creation was written by Rabbi Eleazar of Worms, who lived during the 12th to 13th century. In his writing, Rabbi Eleazar spoke about the instructions for the creation of the golem, stating that Hebrew words and language are central to the process, especially the name of God, which is not often written in full in Jewish texts for fear of it being defaced later, but carries with it the power of God. The Hebrew alphabet was also essential for activating a golem, and there are three recorded ways it was used in the legends to bring life to a golem. The first is in chants, which were spoken around a piece of clay that had been formed into a human shape. The second was a shem, or piece of paper with the name of God written on it, which was then placed in the golem's mouth or behind their eyes. The last way the Hebrew language was used to activate a golem was by carving the name of God, or the word emeth, which means truth, into the golem's forehead. The golem can then be deactivated by chanting the words backwards, taking the shem out of the eyes or mouth, or removing the first letter of the word emeth, which is aleph. This changes the word to meth, meaning dead. When the golem is deactivated, it usually crumbles or collapses back into clay, or whatever substance was used to create it. From these early writings on the golem up until around the 12th century, the goal of golem creation was to create life. The ritual represented closeness to God and would end in the ecstasy of creation. Nothing in the instructions for golem creation suggests it was anything more than a mystical experience for the person creating the golem. The concept of the golem as an active figure instead of an end goal doesn't appear until later in history, when it became a figure in Kabbalistic legend. Kabbalah is an ancient Jewish mystical tradition based on an esoteric interpretation of the Old Testament. While there's a lot out there in the modern world that is labeled as Kabbalah, traditional Kabbalah is a philosophical interpretation of the Torah, which includes golem creation in some interpretations. The legend of the golem fades in and out of history several times, showing up in the medieval era, then fading and resurfacing in the 1800s, thanks to a legend that grew up around a golem who protected the Jewish community of Prague. In the early 1900s, the story rose again and became quite popular in both Jewish and non-Jewish communities. After the Holocaust, the genocide of European Jewish people by the Nazis during World War II, the golem story again rose in popularity, and soon became widespread throughout entertainment media all over the world. An 11th century Spanish poet and philosopher, Solomon bin Gabirol, was said to have created a female golem to keep his house, as he had a skin disease that prevented him from leaving it. He created the golem not from clay, but from wood and hinges. When he was questioned by his neighbors whether he was also using the golem for lewd activities, Gabirol dismantled her to show that he was not. In any case, Gabirol created his golem not just to create life, but so it could serve him. This was the first documented instance in which the golem's role as a servant features in its legend. The 16th century tale of a golem in Prague is one of the most famous and has inspired much of the modern fiction surrounding golems. I'll tell this story in more detail after the ad break, but in summary, a golem was created by a real historical figure, Rabbi Judah Loew ben Bezalel. The golem goes from being a simple servant to a protector of the Jewish community of Prague. The golem patrols the streets of the Jewish quarter of the city, as well as provides evidence at the trials of Jewish people who are wrongly accused due to their religion. The golem, in effect, becomes a hero. Another form of the legend arose in Poland in the 17th century. The story is associated with Rabbi Elijah of Chelm and is referenced in a letter from 1674 written by a man named Christoph Arnold. The creation of the golem reflected earlier versions of the tale. After fasting and praying for days, the rabbi made a humanoid shape from clay, placed a shem in its mouth, or carved emeth into its forehead, and the clay came to life. It couldn't speak, but the golem understood what was being said to it. It performed its duties for a time without issue, but then it either grew larger or became wilder the longer it was active. The rabbi was forced to deactivate the golem, but it crushed him in the process. The new element of this version of the golem was that the servant became dangerous, or ran amok. The 1808 Brothers Grimm version of the tale, as well as many other 18th century German romantic retellings, follow this version of the golem legend, in which the golem becomes dangerous. They also added a moral to the story, in which creating life has major consequences. This version is considered by some scholars as a more Christianized version of the tale. According to Catherine Gelbin, a senior lecturer in German studies at the University of Manchester, while some Christian portrayals of the golem grew out of a genuine interest in Kabbalah, many others increasingly infused the golem story with anti-Jewish propaganda, suggesting the Jewish people were sorcerers and spiritually corrupt. In fact, accusations of sorcery were prevalent in the 1600s due to the golem story. In a 1614 pamphlet written by a Jewish convert to Christianity, the creation of golems and Kabbalah are described as evil. The tales of golems running amok, killing their masters and causing mayhem, became popular along with these anti-Jewish sentiments. Despite this, contemporary Jewish writers still held that the tale stood for hope and the strength of the Jewish people. Contemporary scholars sometimes cite the changes in the golem legend as an evolution from a mystical religious experience to faithful servants, to protectors of the Jewish people, to destructive forces, and then back to heroes in the modern era. However, in the earliest forms of the myth, the golem was usually two or three of these characters during the course of one tale, making evolution the wrong term. History research professor Elizabeth R. Bayer, in her book The Golem Redux, states that a more useful descriptor is a palimpsest, stories layered upon stories which reveal various emphases on the character's different roles at various times. In this fashion, no one text is the true tale. All golem legends continue to exist and serve both as sources and new tales. Either way, the tales have survived and are now scattered through many forms of media. The most famous of these stories, however, is the Golem of Prague, which I want to share with you, as well as its historical context. But first, let's pause for a word from our sponsor. Our regular sponsor is Audible.com. Audible can provide you with interesting and engaging audiobooks. In fact, there are over 180,000 of them to choose from, which you can listen to on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or other MP3 players. MCP listeners can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial of Audible.com by going to www.audibletrial.com/MCP. You can also find this link on our Facebook page and website. If you sign up for the free trial, you get a free audiobook that is yours to keep, even if you cancel the service as soon as you finish downloading it. And the MCP gets the funding it needs to keep bringing morbid history to your ears. So go get your free audiobook on us. Lastly, if you like this podcast, why not sponsor the MCP yourself by becoming a patron on Patreon? There are several tiers of patronage, the lowest being $1 an episode. When you become a patron, it helps us keep this show going. If more people become patrons, we may even be able to eliminate the need for sponsors. That means no break in the middle of the show. If you'd like to become a patron, go to bit.ly/morbidpatron. That's bit.ly/morbidpatron, and you'll be directed to our Patreon page, where you can choose your rewards. You'll have our eternal gratitude. And now, back to the podcast. As I mentioned earlier, the story of the Golem changed as time went on, and was widespread among both Jewish and non-Jewish people in Europe. The most well-known Golem legend comes from Prague. Prague had a large Jewish community before the Holocaust. It's been a documented home to a Jewish community since around 1100 CE, but there are records of traveling Jewish merchants passing through the city before the 9th and 10th centuries. The area of the city in which the Jewish community lived was called the Jewish Quarter, and later, Josefov, and it was occupied since the 1400s. In many texts, it's referred to as a ghetto, meaning it was a slum-like area, with narrow streets and crowded living spaces, where the Jewish people of Prague were forced to live. A large synagogue was built in this area of Prague in the 1270s. It is known today as the Old New Synagogue, or in German, the Altnew Synagogue. And in Czech, the Stará Nová Synagogue. It still holds regular worship services for the modern Jewish community of Prague. Throughout history, the plight of the Jewish people of Prague depended heavily on the attitude of the current ruler towards the Jewish people. Some years they were persecuted, other years they were left alone or treated more fairly. In 1389, a pogrom, or organized massacre, took place on Easter, thanks to encouragement from Christian clergy, in which an angry non-Jewish mob invaded Josefov, killing, burning, looting, and desecrating the cemetery. According to some historians, around 3,000 corpses were buried on the third day of this massacre. Several times, the whole Jewish community was expelled from Prague, but from the mid-1500s to the early 1600s, a golden age of stability and prosperity swept over Josefov. This waxing and waning of fortunes went on for centuries, and despite the instability of their treatment, the Jewish community of Prague grew to become the largest community in Central Europe before 1800. The Jewish people of Prague were emancipated in 1859 and were able to move out of Josefov. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, Josefov was largely demolished thanks to an urban modernization and sanitation plan. Only the synagogues, including the oldest synagogue in Europe, and the Jewish town hall were left untouched. There is some debate over whether this demolition was actually a necessary move in urban planning, or an attempt to eradicate Jewish history from the center of Prague, spurred on by the rising anti-Semitism displayed by the Nazi movement of the early 1900s. But that is a topic for another episode. At this time in 1841, a non-Jewish journalist and folklorist named Franz Klutschek published the first text that linked Rabbi Loh to the creation of a golem. 6 years later, a Jewish physician named Leopold Weisel, who was originally from Josefov, contributed 5 stories to a collection of Jewish folklore, one of which was about Rabbi Loh and the golem. The most famous publication involving Rabbi Loh and his golem was published in 1909 by Yudel Rosenberg, a Polish Orthodox rabbi from Warsaw. This collection of stories, entitled The Wondrous Deeds of the Maharal of Prague with the Golem, featured many stories of Rabbi Loh, who was often called the Maharal, a Hebrew acronym meaning Great Teacher Rabbi Loh, and the golem he created to protect the Jewish community of Prague. Before I relate the details of these stories, I want to talk about Rabbi Loh, who was a real historic figure and was revered well before this legend of the golem became associated with him. Rabbi Loh's date of birth is not known, but it's likely sometime between 1512 and 1526. His ancestors came from Worms, Germany, which is now known as Poznan, Poland. Most accounts say he was born in Poznan. His grandfather is recorded to have been a Talmud scholar and mystic, which could have contributed to Rabbi Lowe becoming associated with the Golem stories, but this is not clear. Rabbi Lowe married a woman named Pearl, who was a native of Prague, and he served as chief rabbi of the city in 1598. Before this, he was a well-known Jewish philosopher, and Kabbalistic doctrines permeated his writings, but it was always presented in a rational and philosophic form, making the ideas accessible to the average reader. He was in favor of scientific research, so long as the researcher did not use his observations as permission to contradict the final authority of divine revelation. As chief rabbi, Rabbi Lowe met with Holy Roman Emperor Rudolf II in February of 1592, just prior to his retirement. It's still not known what they talked about at their meeting, but there are many theories, most of them circulating around Jewish mysticism and Kabbalah. We've mentioned Rudolf II on this podcast before, in the Voynich Manuscript and the Codex Gigas episodes. His interest in alchemy, magic, and the occult are well documented historically, so it's possible he did want to speak to Rabbi Lowe about Kabbalah, but we have no documentation of what actually occurred at this meeting. The meeting is often mentioned in more modern Golem stories as a pivotal moment for Rabbi Lowe, who is often theorized to have performed some sort of magic for the emperor in order to demonstrate his knowledge of mysticism. The legend of the Golem of Prague, as written by Weisel, goes that Rabbi Lowe created a golem to do chores for him. The golem rested or was deactivated on every Sabbath, which is Saturday in the Jewish faith. However, on one occasion, Rabbi Lowe forgot to deactivate or tell the golem to rest, and in the early hours of the Sabbath, the golem went mad, tearing down houses, throwing rocks, and pulling up trees. The rabbi had to stop him, but he himself did not want to infringe on the Sabbath with this task. However, the Old New Synagogue, which was the official religious authority of Prague, had not yet finished consecrating the Sabbath, meaning that Rabbi Lowe had a small amount of time to solve the issue of the golem. Rabbi Lowe led the golem to the synagogue and tore the shem from the golem's mouth. The clay crumbled just as the Sabbath service finished. Alarmed by what had happened, Rabbi Lowe decided to put the crumbled remains away in the attic of the synagogue so no one, not even he, could reactivate the golem. In Rosenberg's version of the tale, the elaborate ritual of creating the golem is included. Rabbi Lowe walked down to the river and formed the shape of a man out of clay. He walked around the shape 7 times, reciting a combination of Hebrew letters. The clay glowed red. Another 7 times, and hair and nails appeared on the body. 7 times more, and the golem drew breath, and opened his eyes, and stood up. The rabbi dressed the golem in clothing. The golem looked like a human, but could not speak. Rabbi Lowe named the golem Yosef, and commanded him to guard the Jewish people of Prague from harm, and also against a priest named Thaddeus, who had it out for the community. Throughout the next 13 chapters of Rosenberg's book, the golem performs many feats of rescue and strength, patrolling the streets at night, but also assisting in the exoneration of Jewish people who were accused of blood libel. During the time Rosenberg published his collection of golem stories, the Jewish community across Europe, but especially in Prague, were under threat from the non-Jewish community, which was documented as using any pretext to invade Josefov and wreak havoc. One of these pretexts was called blood libel, in which the death of a child would be blamed on the Jewish community by someone claiming they had ritually killed the child in order to use its blood for making matzah for Passover. There is, of course, no such ritual, but this racist, slanderous accusation caused many Jewish people to be arrested and sometimes caused riots in the Jewish quarter. In Rosenberg's stories, the golem defends the Jewish community against the riots and the accusations. Once the community is finally safe, Rabbi Lowe brings the golem to the attic of the Old New Synagogue to deactivate it. He walks around the golem counterclockwise 7 times, reciting the same Hebrew letters but in reverse order. The golem collapses, and Rabbi Lowe hides the remains in a pile of prayer shawls and books. This tale is so prolific that the area of the city that used to be Josefov now has a Golem restaurant, many shops that sell Golem souvenirs, and tourists visit the old new synagogue in order to honor the legend of the Golem and be in the place where its remains are still rumored to reside. Besides the obviously legendary Golem, history does not support much of Rosenberg's version of the tale. It's set in Prague during Rabbi Lowe's time as chief rabbi, so in the late 1500s. During this time, there were no accusations of blood libel, but there were in the early 1900s when Rosenberg wrote his Golem tale. These ritual murder accusations have a long history, and were widespread in the 13th century, faded during Rabbi Lowe's time, and appeared again during Rosenberg's time. Another inaccuracy in this tale is that it was well documented that Rabbi Lowe did not believe in magic or miracles, but instead the power of God through science and nature. Therefore, it's unlikely he would have attempted to create a golem. It's not certain why these tales about a rabbi from 200 years previous became so popular in the early 1900s, but it may have something to do with sentimentality, as the Jewish quarter was being demolished, or as a way to escape the harsh reality of persecution with a fictional hero who protects the Jewish community from that persecution. The tale gives hope. This is likely the reason why this version of the Golem story is the most often repeated and revived. Writers tend to morph the legend to address issues of their own era, to critique other versions of the story, to illustrate human creativity, and to honor a piece of Jewish folklore. Some examples of this morphing are Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, the often explored cyborg or robot rebellion motif, and the hero that was created instead of born. While Shelley never stated that she was influenced by the Golem story, there are many similarities in her tale of the monster, such as it being created from inert but natural material, in this case, pieces of cadavers, the monster being brought to life as a test of human creative power, and following the later tradition of the golem running amok when the monster rejects society and becomes violent. There are numerous examples in modern media of robots or cyborgs that are made to make life easier for humans and then rebel against their creators, either due to malfunction, following their non-specific programming too closely, or by becoming self-aware. The examples that come to my mind are HAL from 2001 Space Odyssey, the agents and the machines of The Matrix, most of the robots from iRobot and Westworld, and the Cylons of Battlestar Galactica. As for heroes that are made, not born, I can think of several Marvel heroes that fit this motif, such as Captain America, who through the power of a man-made chemical became a superhero. Wolverine, whose skeleton was infused with adamantium to make him a stronger killing machine, and then rebelled against the men who performed the procedure on him. It's not hard to come up with more examples, but I digress. Retellings of the Golem story, whether it features a golem or not, call attention to the golem itself, and to the use of imagination over the centuries as a tool for exploring human nature. By retelling and retooling these stories, we acknowledge the value of imaginative literature and the instability of the meaning of that literature. The golem represents this perfectly, as they are a servant, protector, and threat, sometimes all at once in a single tale. Byron Sherwin, a golem scholar, states that, quote, "The golem, the machine, while not human, is nevertheless a reflection of the best and worst of that which makes us human. What distinguishes us from the golem, from the machine, is our ability freely to choose this image of ourselves that we wish to become and can become." Edward Rothstein, a New York Times journalist who wrote an article about the resurgence of the golem story in 2006, stated that, quote, "The golem embodies a strategy that not many are able to implement out of fear, meeting irrational hatred head-on, undermining terror, and mitigating its impact with resolve and persistence." Both these statements show the varying character of the golem, and also show that in reprising old legends, we remember not only the value these tales had in earlier eras, but also the importance of the story to our own era. We remember the history and consider the potential at the same time. This is why the legend of the golem has survived so long, and why it brings out our curiosity. The Morbid Curiosity podcast was produced by H. Lloyd. If you'd like to get in touch or suggest a morbid topic for me to talk about, you can tweet the show at Morbid Podcast or find us on Facebook and Instagram at Morbid Curiosity Podcast. If you like the show, please share us on social media and please, please, please give us a rating on iTunes. Your shares and ratings help us reach new listeners and expand this wonderfully creepy community. Thank you to everyone who commented, suggested topics, shared MCP posts, liked or followed the MCP on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and gave us ratings on iTunes. People like John Frederick, Eileen, Anna, Michelle, Allison, Red Devil, Heather, Unicorn Dragonfart, Rhymes with Christopher, and Undeader Than Thou. Sarah, Holland, Nathaniel, and Casey all have my eternal gratitude for becoming patrons on Patreon. Thank you so much. Because of you, the listeners, our creepy community is growing, especially on Facebook, so head over there to engage with other listeners, discuss episodes and news articles, and share your own creepy stories and cute pet pictures. The MCP is part of a wider creepy community known as the Belfry Podcast Network. Check out the other shows on the Belfry Network at www.thebelfry.rip. As I said before, if you really like the MCP, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. You can also give one-time donations by going to our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com, and clicking the donate button. On our website, you can also find links to all our social media and sponsors, and other ways to contact us. If you'd rather contact us by mail, this address is also listed on the website. Another way to help the show is by going to our Amazon wishlist at bit.ly/morbidwishlist. On this list are items that will help us improve the podcast, improve our workspace, and some things that are just for fun. Any purchases from this list are greatly appreciated. We are eternally grateful for your support. My name is Hallie, and until next time, thanks for listening.